Over the next several weeks, as we're in this series playlist, we're going to be taking some songs that you guys will all know, and we're going to be pulling some biblical truths out of them, almost as if they were a parable like Jesus used to use when he was talking to the crowds. We're going to be pulling these songs, and we're going to be taking out the truths in them that we see in the Bible. And today, I want to challenge all of us, and before I really jump in here, we're going to say a word of prayer in just a second, but I really want to challenge all of us to really lean into the message today. It's a little bit of a different message, at least for me to preach, but I believe that each and every single person in this room at one point or another has dealt with what we're going to be talking about today. And so I want to challenge you, make sure you're taking notes, because note takers are... There you go. And so make sure you're taking notes today and really lean in and let's get something out of this today. I know it was challenging for me as I was preparing this week and just believing that God's going to do some cool things. So if you guys would just join me in praying as we kick this thing off. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that we have an opportunity to come into a place like this and worship you. God, I pray that we would not take that for granted. But God, I pray that every moment that we're in a place where we're worshiping you, that we would lean in fully to what your spirit wants to say to us, to what you want to do, the way that you're moving. And so God, we pray that as I begin to speak, that every word that comes out of my mouth would be directly from you, and that God, that you would do what only you can do. And everybody said, amen, amen. So I believe that most of us, both men and women, would say that they wish that there was something that I would change about myself. Like you would say, like, oh, I would change this or that. Maybe for you, you wish you didn't have a big nose or big ears. You wish they were a little bit smaller. Maybe for you, you wish that you weren't so tall, or maybe you wish that you were taller. Williams. We say that maybe we wish that we didn't have as big of feet. Maybe we wish we didn't stutter as much. Maybe I wish that I had bigger muscles. I don't know where you guys were going with that, but that's muscles is what I was saying. We wish that we could have all these different things that we would change about ourselves. Maybe it's even, I wish that I had the courage to stand up and talk in front of people. Or maybe I wish that I had this different job, because if I had this different job, then this would happen. All of us on some level battle some form of insecurities. They're different for all of us. They're ever-changing sometimes. But at one point in time, all of us had said, I'm insecure about blank. You fill in that blank there. And unfortunately, we live in a society that I feel like puts a lot of pressure not only on the women in this place, but also men to look a certain way, to act a certain way, to hold yourself to a certain standard. And when we don't feel like we personally meet those standards, those insecurities really begin to rise up. Especially over the past, I would say, decade or so, as the introduction of social media and the different filters and things that you can use on social media, I really think that some of these insecurities that we have been heightened, whether we, you know, see the way that certain people look on TV, or whether it's social media, or maybe even people that you know, this is something that we all battle, and it sometimes can be very difficult to work through. Maybe for you, one of the insecurities that you have is feeling like you're not enough. Maybe you feel like your whole life you've been told that you're not good enough, that you're not this. I was in fifth grade, okay, and I had a girlfriend at the time, and it was going strong for all of about 2 days, okay? And when you're in fifth grade, that's a pretty long relationship. That's like the equivalent to like a year, you know? And so we were dating for all of about 2 days, dating meaning I saw her at school, and then I said, hey, and then we left, because, you know, at recess time, I had to go put in work on the football field, okay? I had about, you know, 10 touchdowns a day during recess, and I had to go put in work. I didn't have time for girlfriends, but anyways, I had this girlfriend for all of 2 days, and then she came and she broke up with me, which I was okay with at the time, until I found out that she was just using me to make another guy jealous. Listen, I know that's a little bit dramatic, right? Fifth grade, okay, Kalo, get over it. But at the time, I was really hurt. I was really upset. I was like, what in the world? Am I not good enough? I think that I'm a pretty good-looking guy. And especially when I was a kid, I was really cute as a kid, okay? Let me tell you. Best-looking kid in school. But, okay, guys, this is not a time to laugh, okay? That's hurtful. Again, insecurities here. But at the time, I didn't understand it. And honestly, it did. It did something to a certain level of my confidence that I had in myself. And it probably pushed me back just a couple of steps in where I felt like I was at in life. And again, I know that that's a little bit dramatic, right? Like fifth grade. But some of you guys have had some very real instances where there's been some real hurt and some real pain, and there's been some real confidence that has been lost due to people not believing in you, due to people talking about you behind your back, due to people saying things straight to your face that weren't great. Growing up in school, and I played sports all the way through high school. I wasn't the greatest athlete. I played, but I mean, there's definitely people that were more athletic than I was. And so I love basketball. I've talked about before, basketball is my favorite sport. And we're getting ready to go into March Madness. So this is the greatest time of the year for a sports fan. This is the Christmas of sports, okay? I love it so much. It's so much fun. All day basketball, every day. It's amazing. But I grew up playing basketball, and I got into high school, and people started getting a little bit better than I was, and so I was trying to keep up. Well, I had people who, friends of mine, who would look at me and tell me, Caleb, you're not good enough. Caleb, you're never going to make it. Caleb, you're never going to do this. You're never going to do that. And it really scarred me on the inside. There was real hurts and real pains that were associated with those feelings. When you don't have people who believe in you, who don't help you build up a confidence, it really takes a toll on what you think about yourself. There's some real hurts and pains that are with that. And I think too often we get too focused on what other people are saying rather than getting locked in on what Jesus and the Bible has to say about us. If you don't get anything out of today, if you don't get anything more from today, I want you to get this, that you are God's masterpiece. If you don't get anything else today, please remember, please know that you are God's masterpiece. He took the time. He spent the time. He crafted you. He made you just the way that you are, and he does not make mistakes. What you might think is a mistake about yourself, God says, no. I made you perfect just the way you are. And if the creator of the universe, who can create all these beautiful mountains and sunsets and the ocean, if he can do all of that, how much more do you think he took the time to create you and to spend on you? He loves you so much that he sent his one and only son to die on a cross so that you know his everlasting love, his unwavering favor, that you can know that you are worth everything in life. There's no price tag that anybody can put on you because they did not create you. Only God can determine your worth, your value. But too often we allow other people around us, we allow people that speak into our life that don't even have the say that they should, right? We let all these different outsiders say who we should be, what we should be, what we can be, and we don't take the time to stop and really look at what the Bible says that we are. Not what we can be, not what we should be, but who we are. Ephesians 2, Ephesians 2, 8 through 10 says this. God saved you by his grace when you believed. And you can't take credit for this. It is a gift from God. Salvation is not a reward for the good things we have done. So none of us can boast about it. I want to stop right there. Isn't that good? That's good news today. There's nothing that I can do that can earn God's love. And there's nothing that I can do to lose God's love. There's nothing that I can say to earn it. There's nothing that I can say that will ever lose it. God's love is there simply because he created you. God's grace is there simply because you are his. There's nothing else that you can do in this life to ever earn that except just begin to lean back in that and begin to find out who you are called to be and who he says that you are. That's good news. There's nothing I have to do. It's already there. For we are God's masterpiece. And he has created us anew in Christ so we can do the good things he has planned for us long ago. It's good news. We are a masterpiece. A masterpiece. The Greek word for masterpiece, and I'm probably going to butcher this, but I don't think any of you guys speak Greek, so we're okay. So just go with whatever I say it is. The Greek word is poema. It means a beautiful poem, perfect workmanship, or a tapestry. Perfect workmanship. No mistakes, no errors, no flaws. It's perfect. How many of you guys have ever seen those art shows or been to an art show that all these different people, they bring their paintings in and they put them up on the wall and you can go look at them, you can buy them, whatever. How many of y'all have ever seen the sometimes ridiculous price tags that are on these paintings? They're outrageous, some of them. And some of them I walk up to them and I'm like, I don't even know what this is. Like, my three-year-old just made something that looks exactly like this today. It's just a bunch of scribbles. It's some paint thrown on a canvas. Like, I could have done that. I'll do it for free at my house. Right? Like, it's ridiculous, the price tag that's on these things. Or if you go to Hobby Lobby, some of you ladies, y'all love going to Hobby Lobby and looking at all these different, like, paintings and things that they have, and they're all outrageously expensive. But there was a deal today only. It's 40% off. And so, anyway, that's a personal issue that I've got with Hobby Lobby, but I'll work that out later. These painters, these artists, they put a price on these paintings, and we may not understand it. I may not look at it and get it fully. I may not comprehend it, but I'm not the one who gets to put the price tag on it because I'm not the one who created it. I'm not the one who took the time to go and buy the materials and actually spend time throughout my day working on a painting. I'm not the one who created it, so I don't get to look at it and put a price tag on it. It's not my job. In the same way, nobody else gets to put a price tag on you. Nobody else can look at you and tell you your value. Nobody else can look at you and tell you what you're worth. Nobody else can talk about what you need to do better or what you need to do worse or whatever you want to call it. You need to back down on this. You need to speak up on this. That's not for anybody else to say because they did not create you. They don't get to tell you how much you're worth. A lot of you guys have walked around and we've been letting people on the outside tell us our value, tell us our worth, and we hang on so tightly for that if we don't get what we want to hear, we go into a manic depression, anxiety attacks. Well, people said this about me, people said that to me, I don't know how to handle that. And we rely so much on what other people say about us that it literally is killing us. I want to let you know today that if man did not make you, then man cannot define you. If man did not create you, then man cannot break you. If man did not create you, then they cannot put a price tag on how much your life is worth, how much value you bring to this world. For such a time as this, you were created. For such a time as this, if God wanted you to be created in another time, he would have done that. But for such a time as this, he said, hey, I created you for this moment right here. I need you to step up and go and do what you're called to do because you have so much value to bring to this life. But we're so constantly worried about what other people are saying that we constantly just back up into the background. And we let others go ahead of us. We let others move in front of us because they think that we're not as valued. But if my God called me, then my God's going to equip me. If my God says, hey, I've given you this gift, I don't care if you think it's broken, I don't care if you think it's messy, I don't care if it's whatever, go out and use it. We've let the hurts and the pains of life that are real and they're tough to get through, but we've let those dictate our life for way too long. We've let how we feel about ourselves, whether we think that we're overweight, whether we think that we're not pretty enough, whether we think that the next person is going to be prettier, whatever it may be. We've let those things dictate how we actually go out and live our life. And God's just simply saying, hey, You are fearfully and wonderfully made. I don't make mistakes. There's not an error about you. For such a time as this, I have called you. I have set you apart. What you see as a flaw, I see as a way to bring people to know me better. It's time that we start walking in confidence. It's time that we start walking in a boldness, declaring who God says you are over your life, rather than letting everyone else declare who they think you are. You don't need more self-esteem. You need more Christ esteem. You don't need more self-esteem. Self-esteem sounds great, right? Every self-help book has, hey, self-esteem's a good thing. And I think you should think well of yourself, right? You should be confident in yourself. But the problem is with self-esteem, is self-esteem means that it relies totally on me. It relies totally on my thoughts. It relies totally on what I'm thinking about myself that day. Problem is I'm flawed. Sometimes I don't think highly of myself. Sometimes I say things about myself that are very negative. Well, Caleb, that wasn't a great message today. Or Caleb, you talked to that student wrong today. Or Caleb, you didn't treat Alyssa the way that you should have today. The last one may be right. She probably deserves better, but she stuck with me now. But on my own, left to my own thoughts, it's not good enough. I need to know what Christ says about me. I need to know what the Bible has already spoken and declared over me, and so that I can walk in that confidence that Christ has given me. You see, it's very simple, right? So like, you're going through something, you're trying to do a job. Let's say it this way. You're trying to do a job at the house. For some of you guys, you really like working alone. But some of you guys, that means that working alone means that that job at the house is going to take about a year. Right? Like, I love my dad. He's awesome. He's my hero. But growing up, he started a lot of projects at the house that took a really long time to get finished. And if he would have just simply brought someone else to help him, it would have helped the job go a lot faster. When we first moved into our house out here, we had wallpaper everywhere. It was awful. You can ask Alicia Jane. She was our realtor on that. If you need to buy a house, go to Alicia Jane's, okay? Shameless plug. There you go, Alicia. That's for you today. But it had wallpaper everywhere. And so one of the things that we had to do is we had to go in and take down everything. And in our kitchen, there's technically still wallpaper up. We just painted over it because it wouldn't come down. But that would have taken us a really long time to get done by ourselves. But I'm so grateful that we had people who came alongside us and helped us get that done. I had students over at my house, and Pastor Jason came over, and my father-in-law and my parents, they all came over, and we got it knocked out fairly quick. And that's exactly what Christ's esteem does for you. It's exactly what it does. It's another helping hand to come alongside you and say, you got this, you can do this. No, you are worthy. No, you are beautiful. Don't listen to what the world is saying. Listen to what I am telling you. And when we walk in a confidence like that, when we walk in a boldness that says Christ is in me, so therefore there's nothing that can get in my way, I believe that the church would be unstoppable. There's nothing that we could do, but so often we look at our limitations rather than the one that created us, who says you have no limitations. Philippians 4:13 says this, I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. Not some things, not only if you're beautiful enough, not only if you have this type of hair, not only if you're this strong. No. There's no limitations on what that verse is talking about. It simply says I can do all things. And I get it. Some of you guys have walked through some real hurt, some real pain, and there's some things that you're still trying to work out. But let me encourage you today. Let me remind you today, the very first thing that popped up on that screen is you are God's masterpiece. He didn't make a mistake. He wasn't like, oh, well, missed that one when it went through the conveyor belt. That was a bad one. We'll get that one back later. Don't worry. He doesn't make mistakes. There's no error. The way you talk, the way you walk, the color of your hair. These are all things that God already knew about you. And for such a time as this, your gifts are needed. Who you are is needed. I'm glad that when I look around our church, there's so many different people, and we don't all act the same. We don't all talk the same. We all don't know the same people. Because if that was, number one, that'd be really boring. But then number two, we would not be able to reach our community the way that we need to. We wouldn't be able to go out and reach our different friend groups, our families. Why? Because we'd all be the same and we'd all have the same friends. Stop selling yourself short. You are more than a conqueror. You are the head, not the tail. I just believe that a church that has Christ's esteem can really begin to change the world. You got to fix what we believe on the inside about us, learning what the Bible says about us, because what you believe on the inside will manifest how you carry yourself on the outside. Some of you guys are really great about faking it till you make it. You're really great about putting on that smile and just kind of trucking through life. But at some point, that truck breaks down. At some point, it's going to get really hard to keep moving forward, to keep faking it. And I think God is just simply saying, why are you faking it? Your hurts, your pains, your frustrations, your insecurities, those are real. But bring them to me. He says, I'll give you rest when you need it. I'll speak life over you when you need it. But for some of us, we have begun to believe the lies that have been spoken over us. We begin to believe the things that have been told about us. And we feel ugly on the inside, so that's how we kind of carry ourselves on the outside. Maybe that's our appearance. Maybe that's how we treat others. What you believe on the inside will eventually make its way to the outside. Many of you guys know my wife, and you know, she's actually back in the nursery right now, running that thing with all the great volunteers that we have that help her back there. But Alyssa and her twin sister, Alicia, have had a learning disability their whole life. And while they were in elementary school, the formative years of their youth, they struggled with reading and writing and different things like that. And she literally had teachers tell her that she was stupid. She had a teacher who looked at her and said, you're stupid. You're never going to make anything of yourself. Which I know that was when she was a kid and I didn't know her, but man, that makes me mad being her husband. If I could find that teacher, I probably shouldn't say that, but it's not great. I'm a pastor, sorry. But literally her whole life, she had teachers and friends and different people tell her that she was stupid. So she began to believe that. She began to believe that she really was stupid, and she kind of just didn't try. She did what she had to do to go through school. And if you guys know Alyssa, she's goofy as all get out. She is incredibly smart. She's been doing a fantastic job of running our daycare. Couldn't be prouder of her. But Alyssa, in high school, I think because of some of those self-esteem issues that she had with believing that she was stupid, found herself in some abusive relationships. She was in a relationship that basically told her that she was worthless without him, then moved on to some actual physical abusive relationships. And then we started dating, and obviously we've been married now for going on almost 8 years. I think that's right. Don't ask her. But there's been some real things that we've had to walk through and that we've had to talk through, and we've really had to stop and pray about and really ask God to intervene in a mighty way. All because what was said over her she really began to believe, and it manifested on the outside. And then we had some, initially when we were dating and even in the beginning part of our marriage, there were some issues with our relationship that we both had to get right. Just with some different trust and anxiety and some different things like that. And all simply because for so long she began to believe the things that were said over her that God never spoke over her life. And some of you guys that are sitting in this room watching online, you're in that same boat. You've had people who have spoke over your life, told you you're stupid, you're worthless, you're ugly. Ladies in the room, if anybody has ever told you that you're ugly, let me correct that today. You are beautiful. You are perfect just the way that you are. God did not make a mistake when he made you. You are wonderfully and perfectly made. Guys in the room, we need to walk with a more of a confidence. The Bible's very clear that as guys that we are the leader of our households. And for some of you in this room, some of you watching online, you've been told different things about you. You've been told that you're no good. You've been told that you're worthless. You've been told that you're never a leader. That's not true. That's not who God spoke you to be. God declared that you are a leader. And it's time that we as men start stepping up as that and start leading our household in a godly manner. It's time we start walking with a Christ confidence. There's some things that I believe that God speaks over us. I'm going to move through these very quickly. God loves you deeply. Romans 5:8, but God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners. God values highly. 1 John 3:1 through 2, see how very much our Father loves us, for he calls us his children, and that is what we are. But the people who belong to his word do not recognize that we are God's children because they don't know him. Dear friends, we are already God's children, but he has not yet shown us what we will be like when Christ appears. But we do know that we will be like him, for we will see him as he really is. God provides for you fully. Philippians 4:19. And the same God who takes care of me will supply all your needs from his glorious riches, which have been given to us in Christ Jesus. God planned for you carefully. Ephesians 1, verses 3 through 5. All praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realms because we are united with Christ. Even before he made the world, God loved us and chose us in Christ to be holy without fault in his eyes. Without fault in his eyes. God decided in advance to adopt us into his own family by bringing us to himself through Jesus Christ. This is what he wanted to do, and it gave him great pleasure. You are not a waste of space. You are not a waste of time. God thought about you from the very beginning of time. Before he said, "Let there be life," he was thinking about you right here and right now. For such a time as this, you were called to stand up and walk with a Christ esteem. You are called to walk in confidence and a boldness that doesn't come from ourselves, but can only come through knowing Jesus. You are more than a conqueror. You are beautiful. You are smart. And it's time that we as the church start saying these things, not only about ourselves, but about the people around us. If we want to see a change in us, let's start making a change in others. Be the change that you want to see. Start loving on people the way that you want to be loved on. Go out of your way to tell someone, "Hey, you look great today." You look fantastic today. Man, I really appreciated when you did this. And I promise you this, as Valley Community Church, we do that, man, we're going to see this place grow because people are going to come in and they know that they don't have to act a certain way. They don't have to look a certain way. They don't have to say all the right things. They can just simply come in and be who they are right here, right now. If you're someone like me who looks for a title in the message, the song that we're going to listen to in just here a second is called Scars to Your Beautiful. I'm sure many of you guys have heard that. It's by a young girl named Alicia Cara, I believe that's her name. There's a story about how she wrote this song, and she was young when she wrote it. She was like 16, I believe, and she had really frizzy, curly hair, and she didn't like the way that it looked, and so her mom was a hairstylist, and so she took some of her mom's products and tried to, you know, straighten out her hair by herself without any help. Well, when she did that, her hair started to fall out in chunks. Obviously embarrassing and devastating for a young girl at that age, probably for any person, and honestly, I'm embarrassed by my thinning hairs. It's not really falling out in chunks, but it is falling out. But she learned that no matter what happened, she was still beautiful. And so she wrote this song, and the girl that's going to sing it in this is not the artist, but she's a worship leader at Life Church. And her story is pretty cool. Is at like 19 or 20 years old, they asked her to lead worship at Life Church. And if you've never heard of Life Church is this global church, that huge buildings that they go and they plant them all across the country. And it's a big deal. And so they asked this girl at like 19, 20 years old to lead worship. And on her own, she didn't feel like she had the confidence that she needed to go and to lead. She didn't feel like she had the confidence to step up in front of all these people. But yet she says through Christ, she got the courage, she got the strength, she got the boldness that she needed to step up and lead worship that Sunday, and she's been doing it ever since. So for just a moment, let's take a look at this song today.
I had always struggled with my weight growing up, like struggled to feel pretty enough.
I just never fit in. I was always, you know, the oddball. It was like, if you see a group full of horses, I was the zebra.
I really did focus so much on my outer image, and I felt like I didn't know who I really was.
As a 12-year-old, I had brain surgery. I have a 6-inch scar at 18 stitches.
When I hit puberty, I got a lot of acne, especially on my face, and teenage girls are ruthless.
I couldn't be a part of their group, so they kind of like treated me different.
You know, I went through so many years I couldn't even look people in the eyes. Because when I looked in the mirror, I saw who I really was as this broken, hurting child.
I thought I was stupid. And I was worthless.
She just wants to be beautiful. She goes unnoticed. She knows no limits. She craves attention. She praises an image. She prays to be sculpted by the sculptor. Oh, she don't see the light that's shining deeper than the eyes can find it. Maybe we have made her blind, so she tries to cover up her pain and cut her woes away. 'Cause cover girls don't cry after their face is made. But there's a to be
remember first got my patch, but my mommy and daddy told me that I'm beautiful with my patch.
So today, when I think about that scar, I feel like it's God's mark on my life.
When God made me, he knew what I was going to struggle with.
Just knowing that there is a greater love, that's all that actually ended up mattering to me.
Now I realize that the reason why I didn't fit in was because I wasn't supposed to fit in. I was special.
I don't look like a model in a magazine, but I know that I'm beautiful.
Now I see a strong woman that God has created with a purpose.
And so it doesn't really matter what people around you think. It matters what God thinks.
Yeah, I am pretty beautiful.
You're beautiful no matter what.
You're beautiful no matter what. There's a hope that is waiting for you in the dark. In those moments that you feel like you can't push on any further. In those moments where you feel like you don't have the strength to move on. There is hope just ahead. One of the things that I love about serving Jesus is, yes, obviously when we accept Jesus into our life, the Bible says that we get to go to heaven. But one of the things I love about it is that I get to experience hope today. It's more than just simply waiting for the end of my life to get there. But I get to experience real hope right here and right now. And some of you guys that are in here today, maybe you've had a relationship with Jesus for a really long time. Maybe you've never had one. But you need a little hope today. You need a little love today.